Hello and welcome back. Now we're going to be learning something extra about Hamza. I have promised you in a previous session that we're going to be learning how to write Hamza in the middle of words and at the end of words as well. Hamza sometimes comes at the beginning, sometimes in the middle, sometimes at the end of a word. So let's learn this principle. If Hamza comes at the beginning of your word, then Hamza needs to be in the company of Alif. Straightforward principle. Hamza at the beginning of words always come in the company of Alif, whether it has Fatha like Ahmed, whether it has Dhamma like or it has Kasra like Ihsan. It comes with the company of Alif. However, if it has Kasra, it comes underneath Alif. That's a very simple principle. What about Hamza in the middle of a word? Hamza in the middle of a word, it has its own principle. So regarding this, I want you to recall a principle that we have learned before, which is we have three vowels. We have Kasra, we have Dhamma, and we have Fatha. And we have learned that there are three letters which correspond with these three vowels. Remember when we learned about lengthening, we said Kasra correspond with Ya, we said Dhamma corresponds with Well, and we said Fatha corresponds with Alif. Kasra corresponds with Ya, Dhamma corresponds with Well, and Fatha corresponds with Alif. This is a principle we have learned before when we learned about lengthening. So I want you to recall that rule now. The second principle I want you to recall, and don't worry if you don't understand it now, because I will explain to you through the examples. But for now, just know that the second principle is that Kasra is the strongest amongst these vowels. Because we have Kasra, Dhamma, Fatha, and we have Sukun. Sukun is not a vowel, it's the weakest. So Kasra is the strongest. And then the second strongest is Dhamma, and then Fatha. And then obviously Sukun, because it's not a vowel. So we have Kasra to be the strongest, Dhamma second strongest, Fatha the third, and then we have Sukun. Okay, when I give you the examples, you understand what I mean by saying strongest and weakest. So I just want you to know that. So we have two rules. We have three vowels, and there are three letters correspond with these three vowels. And the second principle is that in terms of the strength, Kasra is the strongest, and then we have Dhamma, and then we have Fatha, and then we have Sukun. Now, let's take these examples, and I will explain to you how we're going to use this principle to determine what letter is going to carry Hamza in the middle of a word. Let's take the first example. Ra's. Ra's means a head. As you see, there is Hamza in the middle of the word. Ra's. Okay? So, as you see, Hamza is carried by Alif. Why not Well? Why not Ya? Why not by itself? Let's take this second example. Ra'is. Ra'is. Ra'is means a leader, the head of a department, or the head of a group of people, whatever. Ra'is comes from Ra's itself, from the head. Ra'is, as you see, there is Hamza in the middle, but is carried by Ya, not Alif. Why? Why not Alif? Why not Well? Okay, let's take this third example. Su'al. Su'al means a question. As you see, there is Hamza in the middle, but is carried by Well. So in the first example, it is carried by Alif. In the second example, it is carried by Ya. And the third example, it is carried by Well. What determines what letter should carry Hamza? Now, to determine what letter, you just recall the two principles we have mentioned earlier. To determine what letter is going to carry Hamza, the first thing you look at is the vowel of Hamza itself. And then you compare it with the vowel of the letter before. Let's take Ras. What is the vowel of Hamza? There's no vowel, it has Sukun. Okay, what is the vowel of the letter before, which is right here? It's Fatha. Which one is stronger? Is it Sukun or Fatha? We have learned that sukun is the weakest, so fatha is the strongest, isn't it? What is the letter that corresponds with fatha, which is the strongest vowel here? It's alif, as we learned before. Alif corresponds with fatha. Alif should carry hamza. So you look at the vowel of the hamza and the vowel of the letter before, and then you see which one is stronger. And then the corresponding letter with the strongest vowel should come in the company of hamza. Let's take the second example. Ra'is. Hamza has kasra. So you look at the vowel of the hamza. So it is kasra. And then the letter before, which is ra again, it has fatha. Which one is strong? Is it kasra or fatha? We have learned that kasra is the strongest. What is the letter that corresponds with kasra? It's ya. So ya should carry hamza. Ra'is. Let's take the third example. Su'al. Again, there is hamza in the middle. What is the vowel of hamza? It's fatha. Ah. What is the vowel of the letter before? It's dhamma. Which one is stronger? Is it dhamma or fatha? It is dhamma, because we learned that the strongest is kasra, and then dhamma, and then fatha. So dhamma is the strongest. What is the letter that corresponds with dhamma? Is waw. Waw should carry hamza. So that is the principle. Whenever you have hamza in the middle of your word, you just look at the vowel of the hamza and the vowel of the letter before, and then see which one is stronger according to the table of the strongest and the weakest, and then you choose its corresponding letter to be accompanied with hamza. Straightforward. And we will see that in our text, and when we start reading paragraphs and so on, you will highlight that rule. So it's straightforward. So that is when hamza comes in the middle of a word. What about hamza when it comes at the end of a word? Very straightforward principle. Hamza must be accompanied at the end of a word with the letter that is corresponding with the vowel before hamza. Let's take this example. Mala'un. Mala'un means a group of people or crowd. Mala'un. As you see, we have hamza at the end of the word. Mala'un. Why hamza is carried by alif? Why not ya? Why not waw? Well, because hamza is coming at the end of the word, the rule for that is you look at the vowel before hamza. Here is fatha. La. La. Mala'un. So the vowel of the letter before is fatha. Fatha corresponds obviously with alif, as we learned. So alif should carry hamza. Let's take this second example. Imru'un. Imru'un means a person. Imru'un means a person. Not imra'atun. Imra'atun means a woman. Imru'un means a person. Normally for man, but it could be women. But normally it's used for men. Imru'un. As you see, we have hamza at the end of the word. But it's carried by where? Why? Because the letter before hamza, which is ra' here, has dhamma. And we have learned that dhamma corresponds with waw. So waw should carry hamza. So the rule is that hamza at the end of words should be accompanied with the letter that is corresponding with the vowel of the letter before. Okay, let's take this third example. Muttaki'un means leaning on something. Muttaki'un. We have hamza at the end of this word. To determine what letter should carry hamza, you just look at the vowel before hamza, which is kasra, ki, kasra. Kasra obviously corresponds with ya. Kasra corresponds with ya. So ya should carry hamza. And that's why you see ya here carrying hamza. Don't worry about the two dots of ya are missing here, because ya here is not to be read. Yet here is just to carry hamza. That's why there's no need to write these two dots, because it is not for prolonging, it's for carrying hamza. That's why you don't see these two dots that ya normally has in the bottom. Okay, what about if there is no vowel before hamza? Let's take this example. Shay'un. Shay'un means a thing, something. Shay'un. Shay'un, as you see, there is Hamza at the end of this word. However, it is written by itself. It's not on ya, waw, alif, it's just by itself. Why? Because the rule is there. We look at the vowel of the letter before. The vowel of the letter before is missing. It's this ya, and ya has sukun. Sukun is not a vowel. So that's why there's no corresponding letter with sukun. So we keep the hamza by itself. Okay, because if it were to be a fatha, then hamza will be carried by alif. If it were to be dhamma before it, it will be carried by waw. If it was kasra, it will be carried by ya. But it's sukun, shayyi. So ya with sukun, obviously hamza has to come by itself. That is very straightforward principle for hamza. Thank you.